The following video has several spoilers for the Danganronpa franchise. You've been warned. Oop, boop, 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 boop,
boop. Stanpai.
The world of Danganronpa is filled with a wide myriad of characters, each with their own personalities and backstories to explore through the games, novels, and other media released in the franchise. The stories are character-driven, moving from beat to beat as we follow the actions of the cast, getting to learn about their hopes and dreams and how they face the challenges before them. One character whose actions are arguably the most significant catalyst for the events of Danganronpa is Junko Enoshima. In each game, the ripples of her influence are the source of conflict, serving as the motivation, side effect, or direct cause of much of the conflict that takes place. Her name appears time and time again, her likeness resurfaces even when it seems like she has nothing to do with what's going on, and for many characters, she serves as the greatest call to action from people on all sides of the alignment chart. The despair manifesto of Junko Enoshima is something that has been drilled into the minds of players and fans around the world. Yet despite all we know about the ultimate despair Junko Enoshima, there remains one mystery that has yet to be solved. One that I have been wondering about ever since the moment I realized the most defining aspect of her personality, the root and cause of everything bad that has ever happened in the Danganronpa timeline, was built upon a lie. That mystery is the true cause of Junko Enoshima's despair. Now, I'm sure after hearing that, some of you might be remembering hearing her address this somewhere along the line, and we will get to that, but first, I want to briefly cover what despair truly is in the Danganronpa universe. Traditionally speaking, when someone experiences despair, it is identified as the absence of hope. Despair affects people in the real world all the time. People who are under extreme duress or those suffering from different psychological trauma, as well as those who feel they're at the end of their rope and have no options left. It's a part of the human experience. In the Danganronpa universe, despair manifests itself into something more than just a sense of hopelessness. It also brings about a call to action. Typically, when someone feels despair, they may find themselves broken and defeated. They may lose all will to continue with their endeavors, or maybe even give up on life. In some cases, despair can also lead to rash or harmful decisions that impact oneself and/or others in other ways, ranging from self-harm to overall abusive behavior. Each person is different, and for this reason, we can't give an absolute definition of what despair does, but the common thread always will be tied to a total sense of hopelessness. In the world of Danganronpa, these characteristics carry over, but then they are taken to the extreme. Despair becomes not just a feeling, but an entire state of being. Those under its tyrannical influence fling themselves into the face of danger, seek the destruction of society, and most of all, commit themselves to inflicting even more people with the mimetic disease known as despair. And that's really what it is, a socially orchestrated disease rooted in the mind, spread through traumatic experiences, with the exception of a few instances of brainwashing in certain cases during the series. The catalyst for the world's descent into despair is credited to a single mastermind, one person whose despair was so great that it led the entire human race on a crash course to ruin. That person is Junko Enoshima, self-proclaimed ultimate despair. Often, Junko's motives and influences are one of the most important subjects in the Danganronpa franchise, but something that is repeatedly glossed over is the inciting incident that set her onto this path. It's here that we arrive at the main focus of our video. According to Junko Enoshima, her life of despair was something she's known since birth. While most people in the series are cast into despair by the events and tragedies in their lives, Junko claims that she was simply born this way, that because of her overwhelming analytical abilities, she was driven to the brink of despair through sheer boredom. The boredom of being able to grasp things so easily. With this in mind, her actions, dictated by her own desperate need for mental stimulation, are the natural progression of someone whose entire existence has known nothing but boredom. As convincing as that explanation might be to some, I believe that the truth behind Junko's despair is not something thrust upon her at birth because of her talents. While her talent may have something to do with it, it's my belief that the truth is something else entirely. Junko as a character has a somewhat inconsistent track record when it comes to being forthcoming with people. She will spin a narrative and tease her target simply to find some kind of amusement. This sort of behavior is certainly sadistic, but the question lies in whether or not this is something she does by nature or something she developed through proper nurturing. The argument of nature versus nurture has long been used to try and understand the facets of human behavior, to understand how and why people act the way they do. It's said that a person's nature is with them from birth. You could consider it your default settings. These are simple things like how you interact with others, how you respond to challenging situations, and what kind of personality you have in general. The other side of the coin is nurture, behavior that develops because of the influences around you. The jury is still out on which of the two is the most important for defining who a person is and how they came to be that way, but to discover the truth about Junko, that's exactly what we're going to do. If you were to ask her where her despair comes from, her answer, which claims she was born with it, implies that despair is simply part of her nature. Like a serial killer who simply can't resist the allure of the Mona Lisa and her hands, we are to believe that Junko's despair is a naturally occurring phenomenon, something rooted in her very nature from birth. That is Junko Enoshima's greatest lie. Of course, if I'm going to make that claim, I need to have proof. I submit to you Danganronpa Zero. Danganronpa Zero is a light novel written by series creator Kazutaka Kodaka. Released after the first Danganronpa video game, it shows us what life looked like before things fell apart, before the world was plunged into despair. It tells us this through the eyes of Ryoko Otonashi, a clumsy girl who suffers from recurring amnesia and short-term memory loss. Otonashi is your run-of-the-mill klutz whose very being is, at times, laughable. Relying only on the notebook she carries with her, Ryoko has to fill in the blanks of her daily life while also navigating the political landscape that is Hope's Peak Academy. More often than not, she finds herself caught in rather unfortunate and embarrassing situations, but when trouble does come her way, she generally does her best to avert her eyes and insist that it has nothing to do with me. Ryoko's general disposition is quite friendly, and while she is fond of ultimate neurologist Yasuke Matsuda, she typically can't remember much of anything, even him, most of the time. Despite this, she maintains a positive and upbeat outlook. Now at this point, if you haven't read the book, you're probably wondering why I'm talking about this random girl and her personality so much. The reason is simple. Ryoko's real identity is Junko Enoshima. As it turns out, Junko employed the help of Yasuke Matsuda to give herself amnesia. She did so hoping to discover the secret behind this technique so she could replicate it herself in the future, resulting in the memory loss each character experiences in the first Danganronpa game. While her motive for this is rather clear-cut, it tells us something else that is extremely important. Without her memories, the very concept of despair didn't cross her mind even once. Junko claimed that being in ultimate despair was part of her very nature, yet here we have concrete proof that this was a lie. By nature, Junko Enoshima has zero connection to despair. So what does that mean for our mastermind? Without her memories, she still has her analytical prowess, but none of the negatives that seem to have come with it, which means that her despair is exclusively tied to her memories. Unfortunately, we don't really know a whole lot about Junko's childhood and life experiences. And any attempts to learn more, even something like asking why her and Mukuro have different last names, is met with dismissal. In Danganronpa Zero, we learn about her closeness with Yasuke, and in Danganronpa Trigger Happy Havoc, Danganronpa 3, and Danganronpa If, we get to learn more about her relationship with her sister. But despite these things, we never hear from Junko herself exactly what she went through as a child. Fortunately, there is someone who was there for some of it, and through them, we can narrow down the truth a bit more. That person is none other than...
Ikusaba Mukuro.
As we know, Mukuro is Junko's twin sister. While we never get the chance to talk to Junko directly, Mukuro disguised as Junko is available for free time events. During these exchanges, Mukuro reveals that the two grew up homeless, describing the difficulty of that lifestyle, as well as the nature of people in that world being like animals. This information gives us our first clues to what may have pushed Junko along her path to despair. We also later learn that at some point, Mukuro ran away from home and ended up joining a mercenary group while their family was on a trip overseas. The question that has always lingered on my mind is this. Why did this young girl run away? Maybe it was because she had a lifelong dream of being a soldier, but maybe there's more to it. Maybe it was that, coupled with an urge to escape from her current life. Unfortunately, we never got the answer to this question. All we know is, sometime afterward, she decided to come home, and the two sisters began their quest in the name of despair. Knowing all this, I have to wonder, while Mukuro was away, what was Junko going through? What sort of experiences was she dealing with? Between the two sisters, the reality is that Mukuro herself doesn't really care all that much about despair, as she just cares about Junko. During the events of Trigger Happy Havoc Zero and Danganronpa 3, we see her serving as a tool for Junko, and what personality does shine through is meek, subservient, and socially awkward. She doesn't have the same passion for despair, she just lives for her sister's happiness. And while its canonicity is questionable, Danganronpa If shows Mukuro's inner thoughts. Swayed by the selflessness of Makoto Naegi, she survives Junko's betrayal and instead helps the others escape, defeating Junko once and for all. So that brings us back to the main takeaway. Junko's despair is not something she has had from birth. The Ultimate Despair Sisters are not what they claim to be. They're two people whose despair was manufactured by life experience. It was never something Junko was born with. Instead, it was something that happened to her over time, and likely because of something traumatic. Maybe even the same thing that helped Mukuro make the decision to run away. Junko, as a child, was gifted with the ability to analyze and understand things with ease, but when your environment is one that exposes you exclusively to the worst facets of humankind, your outlook becomes one of cynicism. I believe it is through this tragic upbringing that Junko used the concept of despair as a coping mechanism. She began to fetishize it, even worship it. Despair was the end result of knowing how things would turn out, and whether it was despair in victory or despair in defeat, what we have is a broken person who was made into the monster she became by her upbringing. In her talent plan events from Danganronpa V3, she points out that her birthday is her least favorite day of the year, building upon the already established notion that Junko feels being born into this world was a mistake. What sort of life experiences drive someone to feel that way? What kind of childhood did she have, and how did it nurture this self-loathing outlook? By stimulating the latent misery and corruption in people's hearts, Junko was able to prove that her analysis of humanity was correct. In the wake of the tragedy, humanity was tearing itself apart, divided between the ideals of hope and despair. Everything went just as planned, and the whole world was forced to look at what life truly is through her eyes, one constant state of suffering and misery, where even in fleeting joy, there is despair to follow. With this assertion in mind, it brings us to the final leg of this analysis. If Junko's despair was a byproduct of her life's circumstances, then it is also true that she could have been cured of it. The events of Danganronpa 2 tell us that much. Had Junko received the proper therapy and care she needed, the things that she did could have been completely avoided. Someone with such sadistic and masochistic tendencies alike needs to be given the appropriate care. Instead, all of the people in her life that had the power to do something chose to enable her behavior, for one reason or another. They facilitated her every desire instead of getting in the way of her plans. Each step of the way, whenever she wanted something, be it methodically planned or left to the whims of others, it always happened. It is this kind of irresponsible behavior that caused the symptoms of Junko's mental illness to grow even more and more problematic. Had someone stepped in at any point in time and done something to help her in the way she actually needed, the tragedies of Danganronpa's universe would be no more than a bad dream. Instead, her despair was left to fester, and the results were catastrophic. While I don't have any intentions of being preachy here, I think that if anything can be learned from this, it's that we as people need to be accountable for each other. You can't just ignore a problem until it goes away. A lot of the time, it won't. And sometimes it means someone will get hurt. Manipulative and toxic behavior is recognizable, and it can be dealt with. But the first step is recognizing there's a problem. Only then can it be properly assessed and dealt with. Unfortunately for Junko and the rest of the world, no one did that. Most people never saw her for who and what she really was. No one stopped her initiatives or stepped in to overcome her despite her best efforts to the contrary. The option was always on the table. Junko herself yearned for it. She consciously left a gap in her plans and her schemes so that someone could overcome her. Yet, tragically, it never happened until the day she was defeated by Makoto Naegi. Junko was constantly crying for help, constantly looking for someone, anyone to prove her wrong about the world, for even one person to seize the opening in her plans and foil them. Had things gone differently at any point, instead of having the girl responsible for creating a world on the brink of ruin, she could have instead just ended up doing something much more positive with her life, or, at the very least, maintained the cheerful indifference of her amnesiac persona, Ryoko Otanashi. To briefly summarize my point one last time, I believe Junko's final mystery is the true cause of her despair. Without her memories, her affinity for despair and suffering completely disappears. If that's the case, her despair-driven personality is a byproduct of personal experience, and one that is directly tied to the events of her upbringing. Without these experiences, Junko would just be a brilliant, sometimes bored, but also happy person thanks to the love and friendship of her classmates. So with all of this said, I want to know what you think. Do you think my theory is correct in that Junko's despair was not something she was born with, but instead tied to the traumatic experiences in her upbringing? If so, what do you think it could have been? I'd love to hear what you think. Be sure to leave a comment and believe me when I say that I will take the time to read it. Having a back and forth with you all has been one of my favorite parts of being on YouTube. Also, a big thank you to justonegamr on YouTube for providing all the gameplay footage that I used in this video. You can find a link to their channel in the description. If you enjoyed this video, be sure to click the like button and subscribe for more content in the future. If you'd like to see more Danganronpa videos, I've got a few more right here on the channel, and depending on the reception of this one, there might be some more in the future. As always, thank you for watching. Until next time, this is Stanpai. Arrivederci.